Are you guys ready? Okay, I don't know where the timer went, but I do know that it's time. So why don't we all stand, and we're going to join with musical worship. Welcome to Capstone Community Bible Church, and if you're new here, we want to warmly welcome you here. And we're going to start with Hosanna to worship our King. Hands together. Praise is rising. Here we go.
Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. Turn to you.
Announcements.
We are.
Okay, great.
You may be seated. Good morning and welcome on this beautiful, this feels like the first real spring day. It's so lovely to see you here this morning. Just a few announcements, an update on the property 767 next door. We are continuing to move forward with that process and are really excited to see how God has been working behind the scenes to move things forward. We're thankful to all the people who have been putting in extra work. A special reminder to the members that a motion will be sent out this Tuesday, followed by a members meeting that will take place on Tuesday, April 16th via Zoom. So just be watching your emails for that. Should the motion be approved on April 16th, it is our intention to have a full congregational meeting to present to everyone further project updates. We have a women's ministry announcement. I know there's a video. I don't know if there's also an actual announcement. Yes, there is. Okay. Video first. Okay. Video first.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Bettina.
And I'm Carolyn, and we're part of the Capstone Women's Ministry team. So for those of you not familiar with this ministry, Capstone Women is meant to encourage the women in our community in their walk with the Lord. And throughout the year, we organize women's events that support a deeper connection to God, our spiritual gifts, and one another. And this year, our overarching theme is to get reacquainted. So whether you have been a part of Capstone for a number of years, or you're one of the many new faces in our community, you're invited to come out to these events, to make some new connections, to get reacquainted with old friends, and to grow in faith and fellowship together.
Our very first event of 2024 is coming up in 11 days. On Friday, April 19th, we'll be hosting a movie night here at Capstone, featuring the newly released movie Ordinary Angels. It's based on the remarkable true story of a struggling hairdresser who discovers a renewed sense of purpose by moving mountains to help a widower and his two daughters, one of which is waiting for a liver transplant. It's an inspiring tale of faith, everyday miracles, and ordinary angels. We will be gathering for a time of worship, a chance to be inspired by this wonderful tale of faith and sacrifice, to share about the people God has brought into our lives to impact us, and some time to reflect on being obedient to God's call in our lives to help others.
So if you haven't already registered, please make sure to do that as soon as possible. We like to say, like, do it today, because Monday's going to come and the week's going to get busy and you're going to have a long list of to-dos. So just get it done now. And then we don't have to come back up next weekend and remind you again. And so just head to capstonetoronto.com. On the landing page, there will be an event registration button, so just click that, and then on the Capstone Women's Movie event. And again, it's happening Friday, April the 19th, 7 p.m., right here in the sanctuary. We'll provide a cozy environment and lots of fun snacks, and you're encouraged to bring your own blanket and bring your own Kleenex, and we'll see you then.
Thank you.
Thank you. An update announcement is that our Lakeshore Soccer League registration opened this week and filled up in 12 minutes. And this is just such a testimony to the ministry that has been in the community. It's so exciting, and now we need volunteers. So if you are interested and available in volunteering, there's lots of different roles, and I know more information will be coming out about that, but you can speak to Andrew if you're interested in volunteering in the Lakeshore Soccer League. The last announcement is that this evening we are starting a new adult education series called Hearing Her Voice, and this is all about hearing the voice of women in corporate worship. We would invite you to come join us. There's already almost 50 of you who are, which is humbling and exciting that this is a topic that matters to a lot of you. We would encourage you to come out. Men, we encourage you to come out too. This is a conversation that matters to men and women alike in the congregation. Let's continue our worship. Thank you.
Thank you. 1 John 4:7 says, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love." So why don't we all stand as we sing about his love And regardless of what circumstance, situation you're going through, know that His love is constant for you and for me. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing.
Your love is surprising. I can feel it rising. All joy that's growing deep inside me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Song, we're gonna dismiss the junior high and all the kids to church in the basement. Basement church. Just wanna encourage you this morning. Are we in the morning? Oh, yeah, we're still in the morning. To worship God and know that at every intersection and juxtaposition of your life that He is present. And He is able in whatever circumstance that we just need to call out the name of Jesus and that He is there with us.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. Every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus.
I'm gonna try that one more time. I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Verse 3.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Call his name.
Over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus.
Your name is power.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. Your name is power. Your name is power. Your name is healing.
Yes, it is.
Your name is love.
Proclaim it.
Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire.
Shout Jesus.
Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, speak the holy name, Jesus.
Shout Jesus. Let's go, church.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
Your name is power.
Your name.
Thank you, Father, that you sent your Son, Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit to bring peace, to bring victory, to bring healing, to bring salvation, to bring rest. As we come before you, Lord, we pray that you would till the soil in our hearts as you plant the seed and you water it to help us to grow and mature in all that you call us to be and all that you call us to do. And all of God's people say, amen. You may be seated.
There we go. This morning, Rob will be sharing from Genesis 1, 24 to 31, which reads, "And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky and over every living creature that moves along the ground. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds in the sky and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath in it, of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day.
Well, good morning. So just as we get started this morning into our text, just to piggyback on the announcements that Katie made, we hope that you'll be able to join us tonight at 6 o'clock to talk about the role of the female voice in corporate worship. This is an important topic. Now, for a little bit there, it was like 27 females signed up and like three guys. And I wasn't quite sure what that was saying about the course, if it was just more interesting to females or if guys wait until the very last minute to sign up or not at all. So it looks like there's actually a much larger group of guys. So the last minute one seems to be the one that reigned true. But we'd love to see you there tonight to have that conversation and to join in with us as a dialogue, really, about what does God have for us in corporate worship, both men and women together collectively. This week, we're starting a series. It's really a continuation of our series. It's going to be a 12-part series on the 15% increase in the carbon tax that kicked in April 1st. Thought everybody would be really excited about that and ready to go on this topic. It's not going to be that, I assure you. I promise it will not. But it does pose an interesting challenge in conversations within the church about things like the environment. Because when we start to have conversations about topics like the environment, it immediately becomes political and not theological, or it becomes divisive instead of something that we can work together towards having a conversation around. And there's all kinds of division within the Christian community around how we are to address our environment. Now, I made a mistake a number of years ago. I started doing something that I don't recommend people do, but it's something I do on occasion. I watch parliamentary debates. Does anybody else watch parliamentary debates? It says something about you, so if you put your hand up, I know a little bit about you because I do it too. It is one of the most frustrating things to watch because ultimately what happens is a topic is put on the table and then you get to, like, I don't know if they flip a coin or how they determine which side you're going to take, but there's no nuance, there's no in-between. It's one side versus the other, and it's as far one way and as far the other way as they can go. And then basically they get their two, it's almost like a playground approach to it. You get the two strongest guys from your team or your gang, and they start to fight. And so the one guy gets up and makes the argument, and after he's done, the entire, you know, people behind him, they're up on their feet like he's just said the most brilliant thing that you've ever heard. And then he sits down, and then the other, you know, guy gets up and they do it. And I started to wonder to myself, and by the way, you know, preachers aren't supposed to get political, and I'm not getting political. This is more of a social commentary than it is a political analysis. But I started to wonder what came first, like a chicken or the egg kind of thing. Did our politicians start to behave in a way that then bled into our culture where now we're no longer able to speak about conversations without polarizing them and building them up into some kind of hostile dialogue? Or did culture set the tone and politicians follow, and maybe some kind of hybrid of the two? But the reality is, when we think about our response to the creative world, to creation, as Christians, we are supposed to, biblically mandated to, care. And because it's become some kind of political divide, we haven't been able to figure out how to enter into that conversation without continuing to divide ourselves further, and the church has been impacted by it. But let me just be clear. The call for Christians is to steward creation. And this is not a political response, it's a theological one. 2 weeks ago, we entered into the series called In the Garden, and we started in Gethsemane, and then we went to the Garden of the Tomb. And now we're going to go all the way back to that first garden and just prior to that garden in creation. And this series will hope to explore the Garden of Eden, the reality of the curse, and taking it a little bit beyond just what happened to Adam and Eve and what that curse meant for the world around us. It's going to look at agricultural laws and why they were so prominent throughout Levitical scriptures, and why the Bible cares about how we respond to the world around us. And as we move through this series, we're going to be moving towards a new Eden, a new and better Eden. But how do we live as we're approaching it? It's both physical and spiritual, and it's not connected to our national policies. It's embedded in our image and our purpose. So in order to best understand our image and our purpose, well, we got to go back to the beginning. And we have to look at Genesis 1 to set some of the framework for our future conversations. In the beginning, the Creator created. A very helpful way to look at Genesis 1 was broken down by a theologian. His name's Walter Brueggemann. And Walter Brueggemann says this: the Creator creates creation. So much of Genesis 1 has been lost in arguments that it's not as concerned about as we might think. And so if we use this theological framework for approaching Genesis 1, the Creator creates creation, we have a little bit of our template for how we're going to go through this. Now, I hate to start the sermon with an English lesson, but this is subject, verb, and object. The subject is the Creator. That's really important that we don't lose sight of Genesis 1. Genesis 1 is about God. And when we start to drift from that and start to make it about other things other than about God, we get into some of those controversies that maybe it's not as focused on as we think. And what is the Creator God doing? Well, creating. And that is the verb. That is the activity that's taking place. So we have the subject, which is God, the Creator. What is the verb? It is to create. And what is the object? It is creation or creature. You'll notice it's really the same word that's just being used in different ways. So this is our framework as we get into Genesis 1. And this morning, I believe we can avoid some of those trappings by using this theological framework. Now, this chapter is both theological, which is true, and also very practical. And I think some of the practical application or the functional application of Genesis 1 has been lost as well in the controversies of Genesis 1. And this morning, specifically, I want to look at day 6. Next week, Becky and I, we're going to walk through day 7 with you and what it means to take Sabbath. I've asked if she would be a part of that. She has done a lot of good legwork on that, and we'll bring some insights there. But today, we're going to look at day 6. And here's the key. We weren't the only good thing that was created on day 6. So Genesis 1, 24 to 25. And God said, "Let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind." And it was so. And God made the wild animals according to their kind, the livestock according to their kind, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kind. And God saw that it was good. So all of these creatures being created according to their kind, you can see the poetic nature that's taking place within this. And first God says, "And it was so." And then secondly, he says, "And it was good." Now, there's a literary pattern that's happening. We're going to do a little bit of lifting here together. There's a literary pattern that's happening that you may not have picked up on when you read through Genesis 1. And it's a parallel pattern. And so I'm just going to put it up on the screen, and hopefully this will help you see it. On day 1, we have the creation of light. On day 4, we have creation of lights, those that would govern the sky. Now, why is that taking place? Unfortunately, we don't have enough time this morning to go through all of Genesis 1 because it is quite a beautiful passage and quite complex. But why that's taking place is on day 1, guess what God is doing? Producing light. Now, where is that creation of light coming from if the sun isn't in existence, if the star is not yet in existence? It's this beautiful picture that God doesn't need the sun for his light. That the glory of God is actually what is shining into creation. Now, why is this significant? Well, if you look around the other nations around Israel and those that would have been in dominant power, one of the most dominant powers at the time was Egypt. Now, who did Egypt worship as their top god? It was the sun god. It was Ra. And so this is actually, I was talking to Ben after the service in the first service, this is God picking a fight. This is God picking a fight. He's saying to the other nations, you need this guy. I created this, and I didn't even need it on day one. I have light without the sun. So you're supreme God. I made him, and I didn't even need him for a few days. All right, so that's what's happening here. There's a little bit of a fight. And then on day two, we have the creation and the sea, the creation of the sky and the sea. And this is like the domain. And then on day five, we have creation of birds and fish. Now, why is that significant as well? Well, first, God sets the setting for where they will exist, and then on day five, creates them. Again, looking at the other cultures around, what did the other cultures do to the birds and to the fish? Well, they turned them into gods. They turned them into more deities. And again, we see it happens later on in the week, and so they're subject to the creator. And not only that, we see that the Leviathan was created on day five. Now, if you've done some work around the Leviathan, you know that in the other manuscripts, the Leviathan needed to be defeated in order for creation to take place. All right, so the Mesopotamian god had to go slay the Leviathan. Hopefully you're still with me here, but had to go slay the Leviathan, and by doing so, creation came out of that victory. And God says, slay it. I made it. I made it. Not only did I make it, I blessed it. So your creature of chaos that you named, that's day five. That's day five stuff. God's picking a fight again. Now on day three, we see the creation of land and plants. And on day six, we see the creation of animals and humans. And I'm going to look at why that's significant in a minute. And then we have this lonely day, day seven. This obscure day that gets kind of thrown in there. And what do we do with day seven? Well, if you want to know what to do with day seven, you got to wait a week and come back next week and we'll talk more about day seven. And so Genesis 1, although about creation, remember, is not just about creation. The subject is God. This is a passage about God, and God's doing some things here that are pretty prominent, that are pretty calling out the other nations, calling out the other gods, demonstrating his authority, because he doesn't need to slay anything. He speaks a word, and out of it comes creation. Now, humanity shows up day six, and humanity is not separate from creation. Humanity is a part of creation. In fact, humanity isn't even the first creatures to be blessed in the scriptures. Genesis 1:22 says, so God created the great creatures of the sea and every living thing with which the water teems and that moves about it according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the water and the seas and let the birds increase on the earth. So maybe you're asking this question right now. So what? We just spent a whole lot of time in looking at parallel structure. We looked at some of the framework. What's all of this matter? Why the parallel days? So what if the birds were blessed first? You know, what's the big deal if the birds and the fish were blessed first? Or why do we take the last several minutes to do a literature review of Genesis 1? Well, my answer is because without understanding Genesis 1 properly and spending the appropriate time looking at this text, you can't know why you were ever created in the first place. Now, I want to say something, and I want to clarify it. Our story does not start at the cross. The cross is the climax. The cross is the punchline. The cross is what everything is moving towards and everything is flowing out of. But our story doesn't start there. It starts in the beginning, God. And out of that, we see our purpose statement. And God lays out for us why we were created in the first place. Genesis 1, 26 to 28. Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. He created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Now, I want to share a story with you, and Becky's not here this morning. Normally, I try to avoid sharing stories about my relationship with my wife when she's not here. But if I do, I always ask permission. before even I share them, and look for clarification. I think that, you know, I want my stories to be as accurate as possible, but we find ourselves this morning in a bit of a division, because I want to share a story with you that I remember one way and she remembers another way. She's not here. I'll share my side with a little more authority and strength, but we ran through it. Essentially, it goes like this. When we were first married, we were quite young when we got married. She was 20, I was 22, and we started ministry almost immediately after we got married. I was youth pastoring at King Bible Church in King City, and within the first month or two, we were invited over to the chair of the elders board, to his house for lunch. Now, that's quite an intimidating thing when you're 22 years old and you're going to the chair of the board's house. But Gord was his name, and Lois was his wife. We would have described them at that time as pretty cool old people. All right, we don't use those descriptors anymore, but at that time, they were pretty cool old people. Gord had this souped-up Acura that he repeatedly got tickets for because it violated the noise rules, and I thought, that's pretty cool. This guy in his 70s and 80s just constantly getting these tickets. I don't know why he didn't fix it, but he just getting these tickets. And Lois was very eccentric. She used to go to yearly something called the Lois Convention, where everyone's name there was Lois. Saved on name tags, right? You just go in, and I don't know what you do. I really wish I had asked her more about what the Lois Convention was. But they had us over, and we realized they were having us over for lunch, but they also needed something from us. And they asked if, while they went away, and I wasn't sure if it was to the Lois Convention or just one of their trips, they traveled quite a bit, if when they went away, we would water their plants. It was a three-week trip, and as I recall, we agreed to water their plants. Becky's story, a little bit different. They had asked me, and I had agreed, so this is where the tension lies. Well, 1 week passed by, hadn't given it any thought since they left. 2 weeks passes by, still no thought. And I think it was after the third week I said to Becky, I'm pretty sure they get home tomorrow. We should go water those plants. Now, they didn't just have like a couple of window plants. Like I said, she was a little eccentric. There was plants from all different places all over the house. It wasn't a garden, but it might as well have been. And so I went over the day before they were coming back, and I looked, and 90% were dead. And so I watered every one of them in hopes that we would see some form of resurrection miracle within the next 24 hours, and I'll just, spoiler, we did not. And so Gord and Lois came home and found virtually all of their hard work was gone, all of their plants was dead, and they were externally gracious. What they said behind closed doors, I have no idea, and I don't blame them for it. Now, if they had come home and they were upset and they were bothered, you know, all of this was dead, and I said, well, you never really told me to do anything, well, I might have an argument. But they literally walked me through their house and showed me how to water each of those plants. And so when they got back and everything was dead, there was nothing I could do but own it. I think in some ways, this is our Christian response to our environment. That God has told us, I want you to rule over all these things. Now, the word that is used here is subdue, but subdue is not like a conquering, which is kind of how we understand it. Subdue in this context is a stewardship. I want you to care for the things that I create. So the Creator creates creation, and then he says to his day six creation, look after it till I get back. And instead of looking after it till he got back, what we've essentially done is said, well, I think he gets back any time now. I should probably do something about it. And almost that feeling like it's too far gone. Again, when we think about what it means for us to steward the creation that the Creator has entrusted us with, we have to do it within the context of what it means to be an image bearer. Okay, so again, this is not environmental in the way that maybe we've understood it. This is theological in the way we were created and why we were created. So we are called the image bearers of the Creator. And there's a lot wrapped up in this word, in this phrase, image bearer. But I think it's worth slowing down, setting a context that we're going to use as kind of a launching point for the next several weeks as we continue to look at our series in the garden. When we think of bearing the image of God, we kind of humanize it a little too much. And maybe we look at characteristics or we look at attributes, things that we see in each other. Or maybe we even think physically, you know, like this might be something that reflects the image of God. But that's not really what Genesis 1 is concerned with. And so I want to present three functions for what it means to be created in the image of God. And I'm intentionally using the word function because it is an application in which we are to live it out. So the first way that image is used functionally in Genesis 1 is in terms of royalty. In much of the writings of the ancient world, humanity wasn't so favorably looked upon by the gods or by the ancient writings. They're basically a nuisance in the other creation accounts. And just so we know, there are other creation accounts. If this is the first time you've heard that, sometimes that rattles people. But there are other creation accounts, and those other creation accounts predate the Genesis account. Which means that when we think about what is it that Genesis 1 is saying, it's trying to say something to his people, right? Largely the Jewish nation that would have read this and understood it. But it's also saying something in contrast to the surrounding culture, and I talked about that earlier. They're in an Egyptian culture. Well, he's speaking to the Egyptian narrative. And in most of these accounts, humanity is a pest, not image bearers, something that is a little bit of a nuisance. They were sometimes useful for agricultural reasons so that the gods could have their produce that they wanted or their sacrifices that they wanted. But beyond that, they weren't really worth too much to the other gods. In the flood narrative in the Epic of Gilgamesh, because if you didn't know this as well, there are other flood narratives. This is the Mesopotamian account of the flood. Humans were going to be wiped out, not because they were unjust, as in the Genesis 8 account, but because they were noisy. Humans were going to be eliminated because it's like a bad neighbor you hope move, right? So what's happening in Gilgamesh is these noisy humans, let's wipe them out because they're annoying the gods. In something called the State Letters of Assyria, we read the Assyrian view of humanity, and it says this: a free man is a shadow of a god. The slave is a shadow of a free man. But the king, he is like unto the very image of God. So a slave, he's just a shadow. He's not an image bearer. He's a shadow of the god. The free man, well, he's like a bit better shadow, but he's still a shadow. He's not really the image bearer. But there's one individual, probably this was written by the king or something like that, you know. There's one individual who happens to be the image of God. And so there is no equality in the other accounts. They're either a nuisance or it's reserved strictly for the king. No equality and only one image bearer. And the rest are shadows. Now, in the biblical account, all humanity are royal representatives of God. So if a nation was conquered, you're a conquering nation, you go and you win the war, what do you do to make sure that you don't lose the nation the second you leave it? Well, what you would do is you set something up called a vassal king. And a vassal king was somebody that you would put on their throne so that whenever they spoke to the vassal king, it was as if they were speaking directly to the king himself. So you'd go, you would conquer the nation, you wanted to make sure that you still had rulership over that nation. You left a vassal king, someone that would be there to make sure to rule it in your stead and on your behalf. They weren't the real king, but they were a royal image of the king that had conquered. Now, after God creates his image, creates man in his image, he hands over the keys and he says, listen, I need someone to rule over my creation in my stead. I need someone to sit on the throne in a sense so that when people look at what we're supposed to do, they would look at the reflection or the image bearers of God, these vassal kings, and it was as if they were speaking directly to God. So our role in creation was to steward it, to care for it in such a way that when other people see how we're doing it, they go, oh, they're a reflection of the real king. And part of the role of the vassal king was not just to rule in the stead, it was also to point people to the real king. If you remember, Israel never had a real monarchy, they had a theocracy. They had, the king was in place, but it was never the king that was meant to be the king. The king was always there to rule on behalf of the king. and to point people to the King. So our first role in creation is that we are royal inhabitants of the creation around us, placed here by the Creator to rule in His stead, so that when people see us, it's as if they can see the King Himself. And when people misidentify us and might even begin to think that we are the real kings, that we correct it and we point them towards the real King. That's what representatives of the true King did. And in this way, this is entirely theological. This is entirely a response to how we now interact with the creation around us because we were created by the Creator. We haven't done a great job so far, though. And as Christians, I think we need to care about creation and not wait for political agendas to come out that will tell us how to do it, but that we are the ones actually leading the conversation on how we respond to our environment. Now, I'm not saying that we respond to all of the challenges within it. I'm not even saying that we respond to the fear that we're, you know, okay, if we don't do these things, we should be terrified. I'm taking that off the table, and I'm just saying this in its simplest form. What in your power has God given you to rule over in such a way so that when people see you, they see the real King? What plot of land has He given you? What space has He given you? What other creations, other image bearers has He entrusted to you so that when people see how you lead, they can be pointed to the real King? Now, this theme will continue to develop as we look forward to the coming Jesus, and then we look forward to the next Eden. But we are temporal kings and queens, royally placed to rule on God's behalf. The second way that image functions in Genesis 1 is in the temple. Now, if you were to just read Genesis 1, I'm nearly certain you wouldn't have picked up on this. If you have, then that is wonderful. But Genesis 1 is actually being portrayed as a temple, right? So you probably didn't pick up on that, but let me make a little bit of an argument for why Genesis 1 is a temple. Earthly temples were created for worship, but God was never meant to be contained by a temple. And we even see that in the exile where God shows up on the shores of wherever He wants to, right? He's not contained by this temple. But in every ancient temple, an idol would be placed in the holiest of places, whether that was the creature that they decided would represent their king, which is really interesting, or represent their God, which is really interesting when you think about, again, how God put humanity and rulership over them. All the idols that they choose already fell under what we are supposed to be ruling over. But in every ancient temple, there would be an idol placed in the holiest of places, and it was a way that people could see tangibly what it was that they were worshiping. And believe it or not, that's what we want. We want, or we desire, to be able to see something so that we can have the evidence that we need so that we can experience it. It's just something that's in us that says, boy, I really wish I could just hold something, see something, be close to something. But God's saying, don't do it. And we see the prohibition in the Ten Commandments where idols were strictly prohibited. Exodus 24, you shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven, above, or on the earth, beneath, or in the waters below. God's like hitting all the boxes. You know, all those other things I created, those aren't supposed to be the image. Now, there's a reason why this commandment's in place. It's two ways offensive to God. The first is the Creator cannot be superseded by His creation. And so because God has created, don't take a fish and carve it into something out of gold or sticks or rocks and put it in the wrong place. Keep it in the right place. All right, so the first thing is you can't replace God, the Creator, with any aspect of His creation. That's very important to keep that order straight. But the second reason it's offensive is because God already made an image. And notice what it says in Exodus. It doesn't say don't go make an idol. Now, it does mean that, but it says don't create an image of any kind. Because the second reason why God prohibits us from making a graven image is that He's already made it. In other writings, ancient world writings, idols were always placed in the temple on the final day of its construction. You never put the idol in while there is renovations taking place. You had to get the work done, and then on that final day, in a ceremony that put it into place, you would put the idol into place. Well, what's God do? Well, God creates his cosmic temple, and he puts everything into place, but on the very last day, the very last act of his creation was to put his image into his temple, and the image is his people. It's humanity. In Hebrews, in the book of Hebrews, it says that temples are to never have graven images. And the reason is, one, we don't want to get the order wrong, but the other is, the second someone walks into the temple, it now bears the image of God. We are the idols. Not in the sense of what, of course, the other religions means. We're not, that's to get a little bit lost. But we are the image bearers. We are the ones that have been crafted to reflect the Creator. So function number one, we need to understand that we were called to be royal. We were called to rule as if God was ruling. Function number two, we were called to be his image bearers, those who were crafted and formed in such a way that would reflect who he is. And then the third, well, let's look at the third function together. But before we do, I just want to share this. After every dinner, Becky and I do our best to try to get our kids to do their chores. I've shared that before. And as we know, it's more work to get kids to do their chores than to actually do the chores. Right? It's more effort and more energy to try to get them to do what they're told. And in our house, the one chore that is the worst of the chores is the dishes. Kids will barter, they'll exchange. I'll do this if you do the dishes. No deal. Dishes seem to be like the lowest of the low. And so when I know which one of my four are going to be doing the dishes, I tell them usually early on in the meal. So I want to let you know you're on dishes tonight. Okay, got it. No problem. No tension, no controversy. Now I know why there's no tension and no controversy. Because in my mind, they have no desire to actually do the dishes. They've just agreed to something early on. So then as the meal gets closer to being done, I'll remind that same kid. I'll say, hey, just so you know, you're on dishes. Now they respond with a little bit of annoyance. You already told me that. And I said, I know I have. I did not forget. My mind is not slipping. My memory's good. Because I know what's going to happen after dinner, which is where my third reminder kicks in. When dinner is immediately done, I'll look at that same child and say, now you're on the dishes. Just it's you on the dishes. And even then, they'll say, of course, fully annoyed, but they are crafty little things. They come up with things that you just wouldn't expect. Like, I'm just going to go blow my nose for a minute. Gone, right? They're at a friend's house down the road. You're never finding them. And there's a stockpile of dishes. Now I'm patient, so they can wait, and the dishes will get done. Now, why do I do that? Why do I remind them three times? Because the reality is they're either going to forget it, like on purpose, or they're going to forget because they actually forgot. But either way, they still need to do the dishes. Now, I'm not trying to say that God is naggy. I don't think that's what's happening. But I also don't think that God trusted us to remember something. And because he didn't trust us to remember something, he repeats it three different times. Men and women were created, both male and female, in the image of God, distinct from one another in full equality. And we forget that on a regular basis. Both of those points. We forget that we were created in the image of God, and we forget that male and female were created equally. And I think history would support that argument. We wouldn't have to take a long time to be able to demonstrate that both of those things were forgotten. In other ancient accounts, women are on par with livestock. That's what they were. They were to be used for the gain of the father, of the patriarch. They were to be used to bear your children and make sure that you had the numbers. And guess what? If you didn't, they might just go find a new one and have to give up some cattle to get that one. That is what happened in the ancient world. And it may not feel radical to you, but Genesis 1 is incredibly radical in the way that it is written, because it's not only saying that this humanity that's just more of a noisemaker to everyone else is important. It's not just the men. It's the women who are on equal level with the men. That, in this day, is radical. It was revolutionary. We see full gender equality. That means image or idol bearing, but it also means rulership. I don't think that if you're using Genesis 1 to figure out the roles for men and women, in life in church, I don't think you can make an argument that there isn't full equality in leadership here, because it wasn't just the men who were called image bearers. It wasn't just the men who were told to be rulers. Women in this day, in a patriarchal society, were called rulers, royal rulers of the Most High. They were image bearers. Now let's look at the pattern here and be reminded of a couple things. I'm just going to put it on screen. There's something that takes place in this text, and you might not see it. It's called a chiastic structure. Now, a chiastic structure is built in Hebrew literature to make sure you don't miss the point. All right, so it's basically pointing you to that middle thing. So we see that there we are called to be rulers over creation, that mankind, humanity, that's male and female, by the way, when it's using humankind here, is in his image. In his image, he created them, male and female, in case you didn't get it from the last line, male and female, he created them to do what? To rule over creation. There's two things that I think we've really forgotten that are so important here, and that's it's so important that God takes those center three and reminds us three times. First, that we were created in the image of God. Our faith does not start in shame. It starts in beauty. And when we go straight to shame in the Christian faith and we've forgotten the beauty of the narrative of Genesis or the fact that you were fearfully and wonderfully made, when we start in our sin, we miss all of creation. Now, don't get me wrong. We will keep moving through. We'll see that something broke. We'll see that the wheels fell off not long after this. We'll get there. But why run so fast to get to that point without stopping at this miraculous text, which says that we were created in his image, and that means something. It means something significant. And my sister-in-law told me a couple weeks ago that I'm getting soft from reading too much poetry, and I don't know, she might be right. I think it's just part of aging too. You are absolutely beautiful. You're beautiful the way that you were made. You were hand-stitched by the Creator for a purpose. And the people that you see around you, the ones that you don't want to be bumping shoulders with at Costco, guess what? They are too. That God stitched them together with a loving hand. As somebody, I've said this before, as somebody that loves to get into creation, that's such a limited view of creation. Because guess what? We're surrounded by it. We're not just surrounded by creation. We're surrounded by the image bearers of creation. That means our gospel story starts in beauty. It starts in a place that was crafted. Creator creates you. And we forget it all the time. And there isn't enough Sundays to remind you, enough times for us to come together to remind you of how beautiful you are. Because God made you. And he made you for a reason. And the second thing that we forget, and I think is emphasized here for this reason, male and female, he made you. That gender distinction, which is a distinction here, has nothing to do with the equality in which you were made, but a beautiful partnership in how we are supposed to be existing. And we forget that all the time too. And so be reminded of these two things this morning for our application. You were made in his image, royal, temple, equal. And that both male and female were called to live that out in creation until he gets back. And we have work to do. We have some reclaiming to do, in my opinion, where we've allowed this to become a narrative that exists outside of the church that ultimately comes into the church and then divides the church. And that's foolishness. Because this is an argument about what our God has asked us to do. He's called us to be stewards of his creation so that when people see how we rule, rulership not in oppression but in lifting up, how we rule is a reflection of God's great love for us and a part of our evangelistic message. And it all leads to the cross, and we're going to get there. This is foundational starting place. We're going to get to the cross. It all leads there. But it starts in the beginning. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just pray that you would remind us of all the things that we forget, that we have been fearfully and wonderfully made, handcrafted, artisan, beautiful, both men and women, Lord, distinct but equal, that you've called us to do something. You've given us purpose. You took 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the first half of 6 days, and you told us to watch it, to care for it, to steward it. Not just because you love the rest of creation, which you do, but so that when people see how we do this, we might be a reflection of the true King. Help us to reflect that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, why don't we all stand as we are reminded of this important lesson. Thank you, Pastor Ruff, for that great reminder and the amazing stories that were shared to help us to know we are created equal. I just want to remind you that it's not just who you are, but whose you are. And security and significance comes from God. Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior of that cursed tree. His body bound.
His body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him.
Oh, Lord.
And now may we, who have been created in the image of the Creator, become co-creators, cultivators, and caregivers for all that which He has entrusted us to until He comes back. God bless.